Welcome to the show, That's So Chratheist. What the heck is that supposed to mean? Well, Chratheist is a word that's a mix of two other words, Christian and atheist. It's a made-up word to illustrate that Christians and atheists can have a respectful and intellectual discussion. My name is Truman A. Smith. I'm a former evangelical Christian. I was raised as a Roman Catholic, but shortly after college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian, and I remained one for about 25 years. I preached the gospel on local cable TV and the internet, and I founded a part-time 501c3 ministry for that purpose. Then in 2009, I left the faith and became an atheist. In this show series, I have a number of guests who are active in some role as evangelical Christians that are experts in matters of science and or religion. And by experts, I mean they've published on it or debated about it. And this is a special interest of mine because I left evangelical Christianity primarily for scientific reasons. Today, my guest is Neil Mammen. He works as an engineer during the day and does the work of an evangelical apologist in his spare time. He has a ministry on the internet at www.crossexamine.org, also www.neilmammen.wordpress.com and www.noblindfaith.com. He's also the author of two books, which you can find listed at amazon.com. One's called Jesus is Involved in Politics, Why Aren't You? Why Isn't Your Church? The other one is called Who is Agent X? Proving that Science and Logic Show It's More Rational to Think God Exists. And I haven't read these books, so I'll be coming into the conversation a little bit blind, but that's okay, and that's what makes the conversation hopefully a little bit more interesting. And so I'm hoping for a good interactive discussion. Welcome to the show, Neil.
Thank you.
Neil's calling in from, where are you calling in from, Neil?
San Jose, California, Silicon Valley.
Okay, and I'm based here in the Portland, Oregon area. So here's the outline of what we're going to do. The topic of the show is there any evidence for the existence of God? And this is the format. I'm going to have a 5-minute introduction to the subject with my perspective as a former Christian, now an atheist. Neil will have 5 minutes to give an introduction. Then we'll have roughly just a 45-minute discussion, give and take, hopefully a good dialogue, hopefully about equal time with us. Then a 1-minute summary from me and a 1-minute summary from Neil, and then that'll be it pretty much for the show. And I gave Neil the choice of whether he'd like to go first or second, and he preferred second, so that's why it's starting with me. Okay, Neil, are we ready to go?
Sounds good to me.
Do you have any introductory comments you'd like to make?
Oh, I just want to say thank you very much for doing this. I think we need more of these. I do this personally with all my atheist friends when we go out to lunch and have fun and talk about it. So this is, I just want to thank you for doing this sort of a thing because I think we need lots more of it. Far too often the interactions are contentious and there's no good reason for that to be the case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it turns out our backgrounds are very similar also. I was interested at one point in really, you know, being an apologist and in evangelism, and we both work in high techs, similar fields. So we have a lot of commonalities.
Great.
Okay, so here's my 5-minute opening. I'm just noting the time here so I know when to stop. And let me know too if you think I go overboard, Neil, or overtime.
Oh, no, that's fine, yeah.
Okay, so is there any good evidence for God? I would say no, and that's why I left. I left primarily for two scientific reasons, and that is evolution and neurology and the consequences of what those bring out. So the first one with evolution, because of biological evolution, I think a consequence of that is that there was no Adam and Eve, and that means there was no fall from paradise. There's really no basic for the gospel, because the gospel, when it's preached, usually says that we were in some kind of perfect ideal state and man sinned, and that's why we have this curse now, and Jesus came to reverse all of that. So when somebody believes in evolution, they no longer believe in Adam and Eve. Just to stress that point, there's a movement in evangelical Christianity called evolutionary creationism, and I was part of that before I left finally, but like here's a book written by Dennis Lamoureux. He's a professor with 3 PhDs, 2 in science, 1 in theology, and that's one of the things he tries to tell his fellow evangelicals is there's no such thing as Adam and Eve. It's ancient cosmology, Hebrew cosmology, just like they believed in a firmament, but there is no such thing as a firmament. So the first one is evolution. The second one is neurology. And I think given with neurology, we can say for sure there's no soul. And if there's no soul, that means no supernatural soul. There's no resurrection. And if there's no resurrection, that means there is no resurrection of Jesus either. So we might talk more about that, about the mind and evidence for any kind of supernatural things there. Now, when I was a Christian, I believed in evolution. I accepted evolution. I thought, well, you know, should I leave Christianity? I thought, well, maybe there's still something there. Maybe there's still this idea of an afterlife. Maybe I could just say, forget about dogma. And some of these people I know, they're really kind of mysticists. They kind of go into this mysticism where they had this love and devotion to Jesus. And you read the Bible just to see what positive things are out of it, but you don't read it with a critical eye. And it's really all about Jesus and this hope in eternal life that Jesus rose from the grave, and we can have that. So then I thought, well, is there any way to disprove the idea that there's a resurrection or that Jesus didn't rise from the grave? And my first answer to that was, of course not. You know, there's no way to disprove that. But as I thought about it and went to some conferences and things, it came to me that there are some, I think, hints that make it likely Jesus did not rise from the dead. And what that is that I think there's problems in the Bible enough to show that the stories are made up. One of them is in Acts. It says Jesus ascended into heaven. They all saw Jesus go rise up to heaven, and you know he went past the clouds, and that's the way the story is. Well, in their cosmology, their idea of the cosmos, heaven was physically located up there. So if you're going to make up a story about Jesus or somebody ascending into heaven, they're going to literally ascend into heaven. But if you're going to write that story today, we know heaven is not up there because we have spaceships and space probes. Our whole idea of what heaven is a different idea now. Nowadays, people say, well, it's a different dimension. It's not literally up in the sky. So because they believed it was literally up in the sky, they got caught holding a fib. Now, if heaven is not in the sky, and Jesus knew that, why would Jesus make this kind of a ascension into heaven? I mean, it's like theatrics, you know? Is it trying to put on a good show? It doesn't really make sense, you know? So it would make sense according to them in their day if it was a made-up story, but with today's knowledge, it doesn't make sense. The other one is there's these things in the gospel that show the gospels have a bunch of myth in there. Like one is, it says, when Jesus died on the cross, the graves opened and these dead people walked around. Well, most Christians think that was added. That wasn't really part of the original, even though it's in the oldest manuscripts. Another passage, that was Mark 27. In Mark 18, it says that Christians will dance with snakes and poison won't kill them if they drink it. So that's another example of obvious myth. I have a bunch of other things, but basically, since I'm out of time, I'm going to go to the very last thing. A lot of evidence, and I think when you hear what evidence Neil has, it's probably going to boil down to God of the gaps, which is bad theology even. Basically, it's like we don't know the answer to some things, like how did the Big Bang start? Therefore, that's evidence for God. No, it's not evidence for God. It's evidence for ignorance. It doesn't prove your case. And a lot of the evidence for God, I think, turns out to be God of the gaps kind of arguments. So, Neil, is that about 5 minutes to you?
Sounds good.
Okay. So now you have 5 minutes, and the question is there any good evidence for God?
Okay. Well, thanks, Truman, for the opportunity for this discussion. I want to start off by saying that what I plan to do here is to explain the scientific and philosophical and logical facts that led me personally to believe that the best explanation of the scientific evidence is that there is a God. Now, while I'll obviously be referring to the Christian God, I hope you'll forgive me if, due to the time limitations, I don't try to make a full case for the Christian God. I only want to make an argument for a creator and some of his characteristics. If you conclude that it's reasonable for a creator to exist, then we can look further to see if any one religion has received special revelation about his character. I also want to note that in my experience, I've run into five major types of atheists, and many of these are friends of mine. The atheist who hates God because he feels God has brought him pain, and therefore rejects God and anything to do with God. I've written a bit on this and would be happy to share this with you if you email me at neil1@noblindfaith.com if any of the listeners want to. The second type of atheist, B, is the atheist who hates God because of Christians who are jerks to him or gave him a twisted idea of God. And if you're in this camp, I deeply apologize to you. Some of us, including myself, have made some major blunders in our lives with regards to non-Christians and how we treated them. But I hope you'll see that just because I'm a bad math teacher or a cruel math teacher, that does not mean that math mathematics is bad or cruel. And then number C is the atheist who rejects God because he refuses to bow down before anyone or accept the moral laws. D is the atheist who grew up that way and does not think it's worth researching. So they just grew up as an atheist. And finally, E, the atheist who just doesn't think the existence of God is the most reasonable conclusion. And I believe, Truman, you fall into this category, as far as I understand. Now, as you can imagine, I can't really convince anyone who falls in the A to D categories. A and B takes years of personal compassion and love. The C folks sometimes come around when they discover the natural laws, but that usually is out of my hands. The A through C categories are usually very emotional reasons and very hard to deal with just facts. It's a personal relationship that counts. The D folks, those are the guys who don't care, won't be listening to this broadcast anywhere because they don't care about the issue. So I do think, however, with the final group is I think I can provide reasonable evidence for the person in the E category. That is those with no emotional issues and just don't think there's enough evidence. I've seen people in the E category stop being atheists, Anthony Flew being one of them. And I've personally been privileged to be instrumental in seeing at least four of them accept Christianity. So if you think you're in the E category by the end of this hour, say, I can't refute what Neil said, but I disagree with him, then I would suggest that you really are not in the E category, because to be an E, you must have a good non-emotional reason to stay an atheist. So in my remaining time, I'd like to briefly state what convinced me to remain a theist and be a theist, and we can expand on it as needed. So now, again, I don't intend to provide 100% proof. I can't. We all know it's not 100% possible or necessary to provide proof. For instance, no one can prove that we're not just sitting in the matrix being programmed to think we're having this conversation. But the question is that a reasonable conclusion? And I think the answer is no. So we just want to find the most reasonable answer. Secondly, for those who are listening, do remember, I don't know or we don't know or we'll never know is not a good response. If I give you good reasons to think that, then there are only two reasons to refute an argument. One, you must show the facts are wrong or the logic is faulty. Nothing else works. If I present a good rational case to think God exists, unless you can refute my argument, we don't know is not the valid answer. I could just say, well, we don't know that we're in the matrix, thinking we're listening to the radio. It seems unreasonable, and I think it's a cop-out. So I'd like to start off by making six contentions in the few minutes I have left. One. And you'll probably recognize some of these, and Truman referred to them, actually. So one, anything that begins to exist needs a cause. We all believe this intrinsically. Science claims this. Our U.S. law and the police claim this. If somebody dies of a knife wound, the law doesn't say, well, maybe the knife wound came to exist with no cause. It may have been an accident, but something, some agent had to cause that accident. Number two, anything that exists forever needs no cause. It may have a cause, but it needs no cause, and this makes sense. Because they have a cause, the causal agent would have to precede temporally or causally that which it caused. So if something exists forever, there was no time in which it did not exist, so nothing can precede it. The only cause could be a simultaneous cause, but nobody seems to be able to identify one. Point three, the universe is not eternal and began to exist at the Big Bang 13.7 billion years ago, and therefore the universe needs a cause. Point four, at the point of the Big Bang, we notice four things. A, time and space were created. B, the cause of the universe must be outside the universe, so it's not physically or temporally restrained. That there admits that whatever caused the Big Bang is not natural. It is not physical or temporal. It is supernatural. So if you believe the Big Bang theory is correct, you must accept the possibility of supernatural material or extra-dimensional material existing. C, the universe is fine-tuned. I don't mean in the anthropomorphical sense, but if certain constants were different, the universe would collapse on itself and not exist. It's fine-tuned in that the entire universe would not exist if these constants were not finely tuned. D, while there are other locations we could be in, the Earth seems to be in a particularly friendly location to discovering the Big Bang. And we'll talk about that more if necessary. Point five, now that just because the universe was caused, that does not mean that God caused it, and I agree with it. But there are only two options here. One, that there are infinite universes, the infiniverse, or two, God caused it. I would not argue that even if nothing caused it, then you end up with the infinite universes, and I can expand on this. And number six, if we get to it, I'll discuss why I think the evidence for infinite universes are non-existent, and you need blind faith because you can't see, touch, taste, smell, interact, measure, or calculate these infinite universes, which, if you recall, is a primary reason why atheists reject that God exists. So, to wrap up, I could be wrong, and if anyone could prove to me that God does not exist, I'd become an atheist today. I give this challenge to all my atheist friends. Of course, I realize that if I'm going to be a bit biased because I'm a human, but I try as an engineer and a scientist to limit that bias as much as possible. And please note that I may have trouble stating my case properly or convincingly, but if you're listening here, I only ask it that you don't let the consequences of your logic force you to abandon that logic. I hope my journey and research will allow you to review the data for yourself. Whatever you do, don't have blind faith, and please don't let your emotions, your anger, or someone else's stupidity or arrogance like mine, or ignorance, guide your decisions. It's dangerous, it's stupid, and it's, well, just plain unnecessary. So with that, we can now discuss any of these points that you wish to.
Okay.
And I'd be happy to discuss your point. I was taking notes while you were talking, and so I'd be happy to mention at least a couple of your points.
Yeah, and you know, this is just a free-flowing conversation, so we'll just try to keep it balanced as we talk. And I appreciate the give and take. I mean, sometimes I've been involved in quite a few debates, and sometimes people have one tactic of where they just go onto a sermon and say, "Okay, there's 10 things about that. Number one, you know," and it's like, "Let's not do that technique." Okay.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, that's good for an introduction, but it's not good for a conversation. Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. Well. I guess I'll bring up one thing, and then maybe you can bring up one thing, and we'll see how far these go. I guess one of the most obvious errors I think I mentioned, and by the way, you mentioned these different kinds of atheists, and I think I'm the one in the category that's not. I'm an atheist because of the lack of evidence for God.
Right. The
and actually,
category. Right.
Not only lack of evidence, but evidence against God.
Okay. You can talk about that too. Yeah.
Yeah.
If you have time.
So. Anyway, I guess this is why we appreciate talking to each other, because some people say, what's the point of debating? And personally, I like debates because I think the people usually put the best thoughts forward usually.
Well, also, okay. I honestly think I could be wrong. I mean, I do think I could be wrong, right? And I have better times things to do with my time and my money if I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't need to be tithing. I don't need to be doing all those things at church. I mean, I could. You know, I don't need to be doing debates like this.
Right.
You know,
right.
Obviously. So, and I think I do believe that there's definitely. If I don't think I could be wrong, then I'm not open-minded, and I'd like to think that I am open-minded. Now, mm-hmm. I am biased. I admit that, but I certainly don't want to think that I could never be wrong.
Yes. I think we both agree that you could see radical differences in your lifestyle based on what you believe here.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think one of the most obvious things that really kind of struck me that was untrue in your presentation mm-hmm. was you said the Earth is in a particular friendly place.
Yeah.
So why don't you maybe a minute or two try to explain what you mean by that?
The part of that thing, and it's part of a series of comparisons, and that actually is my weakest argument. The other three I believe are much stronger. But this basically says is that if you look at where we are located, one of the ways we discovered the Big Bang Theory was because of the theory of relativity. And one of the problems with the theory of relativity is to prove that Einstein was right, we needed to see light being curved by a very large gravitational object, right? Well, the problem is, where do we find the large gravitational object that we can use to bend light? Well, the thing that he used was the sun. Well, to use the sun, his idea was, look, if I can use the sun, and if we have something really a light and it curves around the sun, then we'll know that the sun that something heavy or a big gravitational field will actually cause light to curve around it. Now, the problem is, to do that, we need a star, and the star has to be behind the sun, and because the light of the star curves around it, it would look like it's to the left of the sun, for instance. The problem with that, though, is that you need to cover the sun with something, because if the sun is too big, the sun is so bright that you'd never see the star. So if you cover the sun with something, you have to cover it with something that's just the right size, because if it's too big, you'll cover the star, because the star has to be so close to the sun. But if it's too small, then, of course, you'll let the light of the sun through, and you won't be able to see the star, because it'd be too bright. So the easiest way was to find what we'd need is something that was exactly the right ratio. It would have to be exactly as far from the sun as it is as small from the sun. And amazingly, we had something. It's called the moon. It's 400 times smaller than the sun and 400 times closer than the sun. Now, we've never found any other solar system. Now, of course, admittedly, we've only looked at a few million of them, but we've not found any solar systems with a habitable planet which has this relationship from its sun to its star. Sorry, it's from its moon to its star.
Well, let me just bring up a number of points that you've mm-hmm. mentioned already. So far, that's not, you said a particularly, Earth was in a particularly friendly place. I thought you meant like a location in the universe. So.
Oh, well, that too. I mean, because obviously if we were right next to a very large nebula like the Tarantula Nebula, then we wouldn't be able to see even, we'd never have noticed the Doppler shift in the galaxies.
Well, like
notice the redshift.
But like you said, if we discover other planets going around other stars,
so far we've
number
not.
Number one, there may be. It seems like there might be other ways to demonstrate this.
And of course, as I'm saying, is that there could be, but we didn't. We found it was a very easy way of doing it. It was very convenient, and there are many other reasons too. For instance, our location in the galaxy, as I mentioned. The other one is that the equations all seem to come out to be very humanly comprehensible equations. You know, obviously the
that's a different argument, fact, though, about being the Earth being in a friendly place.
Well, that's one, just one of them. I mean, I'm just talking about not only the Earth but also the. It seems almost like some entity wanted to make it easy for us to discover the redshift and the Big Bang.
Well, also about the Moon. I mean, it's not like the Moon perfectly covered the Sun. I mean, it's not exactly covering it. You know.
It does. It covers. It actually does a great job of allowing the light from the star.
Right, but it's not. But it's not an exact overlap. Like it's exactly the same size.
It's close enough that it allows us to do the experiment. In other words, if the moon was a few sizes bigger, you know, if it was a percentage like a 5% bigger, then it would not have worked. Okay. Saying that I'm giving the numbers are sort of arbitrary because I would have to give you the exact research. And by the way, the data is from the book, The Privileged Planet, if you're interested in finding out more. And that will actually give you more detail on that. So basically I'm saying that if things had been tweaked a little here or there, things would have been a lot difficult. Now, I'm not saying that it's impossible for us to have discovered it. So let me make one more point. And then my preference, actually, as I said, this is the weakest link. We've got to take all the evidence together. So my final point on this one is basically – most planets have either no atmosphere or an opaque atmosphere. But there's no requirement for life to have a transparent atmosphere. There is a requirement for life to have a radiation-protective atmosphere. And why is this important? Because early astronomy was a hobby. A transparent atmosphere allowed early amateurs to actually see way out there and study cosmology. And that's how astronomy actually became a science, and we found the redshift, and we found the Big Bang. So,
okay, well,
just kind of things like that.
Yeah, okay, well, those are, so I was just basically talking about this one thing, too. Like, for example, you said that the moon were like 5% bigger, then we'd probably have a problem. But, see, I don't know, and I would like to look into this, but I would imagine if the moon was 50% bigger, it probably wouldn't be, it probably wouldn't, well.
It wouldn't have any life if it was 50%
no,
bigger.
No, I was just saying that as far as the eclipse and it did have to be a full eclipse, I understand, but anyway, that's something to look up.
And if it was too big, then the star can only be a certain distance behind it, the side of it. Otherwise, the light would not curve around it, because otherwise, then the light would just go straight. See?
Okay. Well, okay. So you said this is not one of your. You said this is one of your.
I'm just saying this
ones.
Is one of the four points, and we have to take all the points together.
Okay.
On its own, it's like, for instance, if you're looking at a murder mystery and you say, "Well, the guy had red hair," the murderer had red hair. Well, you know, lots of people have red hair.
Okay. Yeah.
But when
so
you start taking all the points together, you go, "Well, wow, that seems to be fine tuning something." I mean,
right.
My argument, the evidence seems to point to somebody in specific.
Okay. So I guess what I'll ask next time is, like, tell me what your strongest argument is. And
I think the strongest argument is the beginning
of
the.
Before we go there, I brought this one up. Why don't you bring up something about what I said
or
a question you have for me, and then I'll go back and ask you what your strongest
Sounds good.
One is.
Sounds good. Let me go to my notes for you. Now, you talked about neurology and the no soul, so no resurrection, right?
Yeah.
And you also talk about miracles and ascending into heaven. So let me suggest something. Now, at the point of the Big Bang, we've calculated and we've postulated that there were at least 10 dimensions, and you've probably heard of M theory, right?
Yeah, you're talking about string theory.
Yeah, string theory. And so basically, there are many different views of this. One of the views of this is that these other dimensions are actually spatial dimensions. And these spatial dimensions, you know, it would be like a wormhole where the space is curved and there's a dimensional interconnection between two parts of the universe, which would be another, a fourth dimension or a fourth spatial dimension. The dimensions being height, width, and length, right? So imagine if, and this is why I think it's very interesting that science says, hey, you know, we've got multiple dimensions, and of course, we know we've created the Large Hadron Collider or designed the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland to try and send an alpha particle into the fifth dimension or the fourth spatial dimension. So this isn't just science fiction. It's actually something that we're working on right now. So when you say it's not possible to have a soul, imagine if you now you've seen the you've heard about flatland, right? It's multidimensional.
Sure.
You know,
yeah.
You've got the two-dimensional being, and it can't imagine a three-dimensional
right.
being.
Right, right.
So imagine if we are, say, four-dimensional beings or five-dimensional beings, right?
Mm-hmm.
In which case, then our soul, and in fact, in Christian theology, and you should know this, we don't think that you have a soul. We think that you are a soul. You have a body. So that soul would be a multidimensional soul. In fact, we believe that Christ's resurrected body was a multidimensional body. And in which case, that body, if the soul exists in that body, all it would be doing, it would be just like controlling the body. Make sense? So therefore, it is possible to have a soul, and science in the three-dimensional science would never be able to detect it.
Well,
now, five-dimensional science might be able to detect it. Now, I'm actually saying that science seems to indicate that there are multiple dimensions. Now, you could say, well, you're just postulating that. Of course I'm just postulating that. But I'm thinking that science actually seems to say, hey, you know what, these people talking about the soul and all that actually kind of knew what they were talking about long before science came on the scene to be able to prove that they actually may have had a soul.
Well, have you heard of the term the homunculus?
No, I'm not familiar with that.
Okay, so there's this ancient idea, you know, there's this what they call the mind-body problem in philosophy. Basically, and also science, basically the idea is if our brain and our mind is all just material, how does chemical reactions give rise to thoughts? And that's an area of research.
Right.
It used to be that people thought we had this homunculus in our brain. So it's kind of like this person who's in control, overlooking everything that's going on, you know, like looking at this and looking at that and looking at this. But what we found out from neurology is that that's not the way the brain works at all. What happens is there's a lot of actually parallel processing going on.
Mm-hmm.
There's
yeah.
a whole bunch of subconscious processing. And so there is not one person, like, overlooking everything. So this idea of the homunculus has basically been disproven.
Well, but again, I'm not suggesting anything like that. I'm suggesting that there is a multidimensional, we are multidimensional beings, and our soul exists in that multidimensional space. And, again, as I was saying, it's possible that our soul exists in that multidimensional space. And what's interesting about that is that soul would not be one controlling entity. It would not be different from our body. It would just be another aspect of who we are.
Well, see, the word soul, kind of like the word God, is really vague. In fact, every theologian, even the theologians in your denomination, by the way, do you mind saying what your denomination is?
It's non-denominational Protestant.
Yeah, so if you were to go, did you ever attend a seminary?
No.
If you did, what kind of seminary would you go to, you think?
Oh, probably something like Biola.
Okay, so I think even at Biola, they would say, what is a soul? And when you look in the theological textbooks or the theology books, they have different ideas, and people don't even really know what a soul
yeah,
is.
Yeah, of course, yeah, and that's fine. So they don't understand fully what this is because it's a concept that we, even today, don't fully understand, but that does not mean that science can't explain it.
Well, here's what I think a soul is. I don't believe God exists, and
yeah.
I believe that people are afraid of death. And so when you see somebody die, obviously that's it. But if you want to build up a comforting position, picture, hey, there's an afterlife. Well, how
right.
could there be an afterlife? You see this dead person on the ground. Oh, well, there's this other thing you can't see. It's invisible, can't measure it or anything, and that's the soul. That's the part that lives on. So,
right,
and
that's a good explanation for what we want. But remember, just because we want something doesn't mean that it's not true. You know, we want a reason for the afterlife, but that does not mean the afterlife is not true. I mean, I mm-hmm. want the sun to rise tomorrow. That doesn't mean it won't rise, right? So my desires have nothing to do with the validity of whether it's true or not. It just is one possible alternative explanation to whether it's true or not.
Well, I guess it's like...
So it's not a falsifying piece. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Well, the idea is to believe in a soul, it's this part of me that lives on after my physical body dies.
Right.
And so what is me? I mean, we know that you basically, I mean, it's so obvious, I think, from an atheistic standpoint, a materialistic standpoint, that you emerge as your brain emerges. In other words, when you're a toddler, you don't have the mind you have now. You don't have the personality you have.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're conceived, when the sperm hit the egg, there is one cell. There's not even a brain or anything.
Right.
So what you are is basically comes out of your brain. So what is a soul? I mean... If there's a conception and a sperm meets an egg and it divides 16 times and then there's a natural miscarriage, I mean, that's another perplexion with the soul is when does it come into play?
Well, think of a symbiotic relationship, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you've got a, and I have to be cautious about this because I don't want to take this as theology, but I just want to try and explain it. So let's think of a symbiotic relationship, a computer firmware, right?
Yeah.
Running on some hardware. Is the computer the hardware or is it the firmware? Well, it's both. It's a symbiotic relationship between both of these, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you can't, if I take that hardware and I substitute a different hardware, unless that firmware can adapt to it, that computer will look different. It'll feel different. If I take the hardware and I put different firmware on it, right,
mm-hmm.
the computer will be different too. You know, I'll be running Linux, for instance, or Windows or whatever, right?
All right.
So you can see that there's a variation there of symbiotic relationships that will actually classify and make whatever you're dealing with completely different. And yet, if I were to take apart the computer and look at it, I would not be able to find the intelligence of the computer because the intelligence of the computer came from the firmware which was written by somebody else, and that takes us into a completely different area, which I don't think we need to go right now.
Well, what do you mean by what do you mean you couldn't find the intelligence of it? I mean, if you take a computer apart, you can see the hardware and software.
You can see the hardware. You can't see the software, but you could see the electrons. You could presumably see the electrons stored there. But what is the meaning of those electrons? Again, as I said, this is just an analogy, and some analogies fail at some point, so I don't want to go too far on that. But my point here, though, is what I'd like to mm-hmm. explain is if the universe, as we think it is, and science provides at least 10 dimensions, and there are at least 6 other dimensions, mm-hmm. can intelligent life exist in those dimensions? And you're saying, no, they can't. And I'm saying, absolutely, why not? Because we don't know anything about those dimensions, and they provide an ample explanation. Not only that, they also provide an explanation of how maybe demons and angels could exist, and they would intersect our plane and disappear from our plane. And this actually may even go into this whole rising to the ascending.
But, you know, in your introduction, you said that, you know, the quote, we don't know, if you say something we don't know, that's not a good answer for anything for God. And so it sounds like here you're going into that I don't know realm, and therefore that could be evidence for God.
No. I'm just providing you, I'm just answering your question, saying that this is a possible answer to your whole neurology, no soul.
But what's the answer? The answer is you don't know. We don't know what, how can you say this could be a possible solution when we don't know what it is?
But you can't say that that is not the right answer. You can just say that this is something we don't know in that area. But when I provide my explanation for God, when I provide my evidence for God, I'm saying I'm providing some concrete examples. So saying I don't know at that point is wrong, not at this point.
Well,
this is,
okay, let's look at your computer example. What if, for example, I said I had special powers, I could wave my hands over the computer and I could make it do whatever I want to do?
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't believe in that. And if I said, well,
I would think that you had a camera there that was looking at you had a Kinect connected to it. I realize that's not your intention because all analogies fall at some point. But so I missed your point.
Okay, so let's say there is no camera.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, look at this trick I can do. It's a really neat trick. In fact, I'll just stare at it.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll read my mind. It'll put the exact words on the screen.
Mm-hmm.
And there's not even a camera involved. In fact,
In fact,
the computer's in the other room, and I could telepathically change it.
But that's presuming a couple of things, isn't it?
What?
One, it's presuming that that connection does not exist, and I know that that connection does not exist. Right? You're saying that, assuming that there's no camera, well,
mm-hmm.
we're assuming that there may be a camera, right?
Well, I guess
how can you prove?
I'm saying
that there is a fourth dimension or a fifth dimension. Science tells us there's a fourth and fifth dimension, and you're saying, well, then there's no intelligent life in those fourth and fifth dimensions. There's no intelligent being in those fourth and fifth dimensions.
Well, my biggest objection to that argument is that we know how the brain works, and we know the mind emerges from the brain, and so that's not a mystery. And so then. So what is the soul? I mean, usually the soul is your personality. No, it's not really the personality. Well, maybe it's your intelligence. No, it's not really intelligence. And
it's a
like
combination of both. Just like I mentioned, the computer, it's a combination. It's the mixing off your hardware and your software, if you will.
Well, here's
and
one of the big
problems. The personality is, sorry, let me rephrase that. The personality is a mixing of the hardware and the software.
Here's one of the big problems with that, though, is that there's nothing really new with humans. I mean, you can say it's different in degree, not kind. Everything that we have as far as personality, intelligence, and all that thing, all those mm-hmm. things, the animals also have some measure of it. Unless you say, well, the thing we don't have is, the thing we have is worshiping God. They don't have that. Well, that's because of our advanced brains and our communication. We could have advanced concepts. They also don't have physics and algebra and calculus, but mm-hmm. we do because we came up with those things.
Well, I don't think we came up with them. We discovered them.
So they always
existed. We just found them.
What is the soul then? If other animals show morality, signs mm-hmm. of morality, they show signs of intelligence by making tools. Are these animals also going to? I mean, do they go to heaven or hell when they die? And then you got to say, well, what kind of degree of animals? Like, well, maybe dogs because they're smart and they're our pets and we love
yeah,
them.
Yeah,
but
again, you're
not the ants. You know, so maybe like, you know, you might say, well, some more complex animals, like the dogs, because they're our pets, are closer to us, so maybe they'll go to heaven, but not the ants because they have more simpler brains and we don't like them, or mosquitoes, or, you know, those.
Now, Truman, remember this, though. Just because you have a question that is unanswerable does not mean that there is no answer, or it does not mean that the reason that you're, I mean, the base for which you're asking that question is false, right? So
but
just because I can't answer whether dogs go to heaven does not mean that, like, for instance, if I can't answer what the square root of 52 is, it doesn't mean that there is no square root of 52. If other evidence leads to that fact that there is a square root of 52, you know, then we should say, well, okay, he just doesn't know it. So if you ask me, you know, what do dogs do, or what's the actual definition of the soul, or what's the definition of this or that, that does not mean it doesn't exist. It just means that I don't know personally the answer. But if I say, look, there is a multidimensionality there, and it does seem to explain what the soul could be, and it does seem to explain all these other things, I mean, including rising from the dead and miracles and things of that. In fact, they even could explain ascending. Because if in Flatland, if something went up, they don't have a word for up, so they would say, well, it went left. So in three-dimensional land, we don't have a word for fourth dimension, so we would just say up, right? So there's also an explanation for those scenarios or the vocabulary that we're limited with.
Okay, well, so back to the animals. I mean, it used to be that the theologians would say, well, our soul is our intelligence. You know, the animals are not intelligence. They're just
And they were wrong,
you know,
obviously.
And that's not right. And then
theologians
say, well,
also said the world was flat. Not flat, but the world was the center of the universe. And so.
Well, they also said that, you know, only humans have morality. And then they found out through other studies that there's a lot of morality, elementary examples of morality with the animals also.
Yeah, yeah. But so, I think morality is natural law, so that doesn't really affect me. I mean, any creature, any being that follows the natural law or studies the natural law can realize what morality is. Maybe not to the full extent, but they can understand it.
Okay, how about it? You want to go on to another topic, or is there anything else
sure.
you want to say about
that? No, that's good. You want to ask me one?
I would like to ask you, I guess, one thing I'm thinking about, too, is when I was an evangelical Christian, I kind of started off being partial to young earth creationism. Then I went to old earth creationism. Well, you know, young earthers say that the universe and the earth are, you know, just a couple of days apart. They're both only about 10,000 years old. Then the old earthers say, no, the cosmology is pretty much right according to modern science. And the earth is billions of years old and the sun was formed first. But we still reject evolution, biological evolution of humans from animals. And then evolutionary creationism takes another step and says, oh, really, all of modern science is correct. The Bible is not about science. Yes, we evolved, and that was God's design choice. And I believed that before I left. So now I'm what you might call a naturalist. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering, where are you on that, you know, as far as young earth, old earth?
Well, I'm an old earth creationist and intelligent design. So where I would fall is I would say that there is nothing in the Bible that basically contradicts the Big Bang theory. In fact, if you understand the word yom, in fact, I grew up as an old earthist because my dad's a professor in physics, And it always occurred to me that, and I grew up in the Middle East, so I grew up in Yemen and Sudan, speaking Arabic. And so to me, the word yom was a word I use in my daily basis, because Arabic uses the word yom too for day or age or eon. So when I read the Bible and looked at the word day and understood it was written as yom, I always understood it to be, could be, you know, a period of time or whatever. So there was never any contradiction for me. I mean, never issues with
me. Well, let me ask you a question relating on this. And usually as an old earth creationist, you're probably familiar with Reasons to Believe ministry.
Yes, of course. Yeah. In fact, a lot of the information that I would hold to would be very similar to Hugh Ross's. Yeah.
Now, so I think one of the things that really doesn't make sense about their position is that they believe that the Noah's Ark story, basically they think there was a global flood, but it was in a local area, and it wiped out all the humans in that area.
I mean, again, I don't want to make representations for them because I may be wrong, but from what I understand, they believe in a local flood, not a global flood. And all it did was wipe out the humans in that area, and all it would need to do is carry the humans and the animals needed. Now, of course, somebody might say, well, why do an ark? Why not just take a long hike, you know,
exactly,
and wait for this all to pass away? But again, remember, the intent there was to show God's miracle and pass things down to a nation. And God can do many things in many different ways. An ark is kind of a flamboyant way of doing things.
Well, also, it's like, why would you say birds? Birds can just fly away from a local flood. Why would
it
you
depends
say
on what kind of birds and all that. And there are all other options. Yeah.
I mean, the ravens, for example.
If they were in their local area, then they would have taken the ravens with them. And I think the raven had a different purpose, too. I think the ravens were used for things like, in the end, he used the ravens to locate if the ark was, you know, if the water had receded in the area they were in and things like that.
Yeah, so I mean,
again, I don't want to represent their view as much. I personally think it's quite possible it was a global flood, and we just don't have the geological evidence to prove that yet. You know, and there are some difficulties with the local flood of global flood, and both have their difficulties.
Yeah, I mean, there's, as far as I'm concerned, I mean, there's so much evidence, geological evidence and things that go against a global flood. I mean, that's why it's so obviously not a global flood, and that's why I think the Reasons to Believe people say it was a local flood, but then it doesn't make sense to say that all the humans were wiped out, because the humans wouldn't have been all in one area anyway.
Well, I think if you look at the numbers, it's quite possible they were in that area, and they were in, because they didn't want to part. Because if you follow on to the Tower of Babel, remember, or the Tower of Babel, depending on how you pronounce it, they didn't want to part. They all wanted to stick around together, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, of course, yeah, if that's all you know is the Bible, but I think when you know science and about how animals spread out, they're not going to, it would be really out of character for humans.
Yeah, but again, I think that's postulation at that point.
Okay, why don't you give me a question, and I'll have another one for you, I think.
Well, actually, rather than doing that, I'd like to expand on one of the issues, because I actually don't really have any more questions for you, because your introduction covered those three things. Oh, yeah, miracles. Let me talk about miracles. Let me ask you about miracles. Why do you think miracles are impossible?
Oh, I wouldn't say they are not impossible. I would just say that there are so many. Number one, there are people who claim to do miracles now. I mean, that's what magicians do.
Right.
There are people who claim to do miracles. And have you ever heard of the James Randi Foundation?
Yes, I'm quite familiar with him. I actually kind of like what he does.
Yeah. So if anybody can prove anything supernatural, like a miracle, they can
get
a million dollar prize. Yeah.
Yeah.
And some people have came forward and they've been actually proved to be self-deluded. They thought they actually could do a miracle, and under a scientific test, they can't. And they're amazed themselves that they can do it.
There are lots of fakers and self-deluded people on TV and around the world. So
yeah.
I'm not. To me, it's not an issue of. It's not an issue of whether it happens right now or not, but whether when it happens, is it going to happen for a specific purpose?
And yeah. So I would say there's no shortage of miracles in sacred books, but I would say, you know, it's kind of funny how they could be done in the ancient days without the video camera and without scientists overlooking them, but nowadays they can't perform it.
Well, if you look throughout, and this is one of the arguments I have with some of my friends. They're like, oh, well, we expect a miracle here and there. And I say, you know, do you know how many miracles there are in the Old Testament, the New Testament, all to put together? I said, if you compare them all, we're not talking about a miracle every few days. I mean, altogether, maybe there is something like 400 miracles in the entire Bible. I mean, this is something like a miracle every 40 years. It's not, you know, it's not something like a daily basis, because if it was a daily basis, it wouldn't be a miracle. It would be a wonder, right?
Yeah, I think the thing with Jesus, though, is miracles are a really big part, because it's like anybody, you know, I could say, look, I'm God. I'm mm-hmm. God incarnate. Then they say, like, yeah, right. Everybody says they're God. There's people in the loony bin, they say they're God. Prove it. Well, how could I possibly
prove
it?
So he would have to
prove it. I'll do a miracle.
Exactly.
That's how I would prove it.
Yeah. Exactly, and I believe that. So let me. While I'm not, you know, there's no way I can prove that the miracles happen. Let me explain one reason why I think miracles are definitely possible. First of all, if there is a God, you would admit that he can create matter and energy, in which case he can create matter and energy anytime, right? So he can definitely bring somebody back to life.
Yeah, I believe if there was a God, he can do all those things.
Okay.
Sure.
So you also believe that we, at some point, will be able to do things that would be conceived as miracles, right?
It would be conceived as miracles to our naive, as we are naive scientifically now, but in the future when they do it, it would not be perceived as a miracle.
Exactly. So the issue is not that it's impossible, but it's improbable. So, for instance, I was talking to a friend of mine, and he said, so how did Jesus feed the 5,000? I said, none of the miracles are logically impossible, but they are improbable. For instance, how did he feed the 5,000? Well, we all know about matter-energy conversion. So what you're just asking me is, how did Jesus manage to do matter-energy conversion 2,000 years ago, when here we are, we don't even know how to do it yet, but we know it's possible one day, maybe.
Well,
right?
I think as a Christian, you have... Speaking as a Christian, I think you have the wrong answer there, because it looks like you're going down a tact of trying to explain how these things can be done scientifically. But why don't you just say it's a miracle? God can do whatever he wants to. You don't have to have a rational explanation.
No, because I don't think God does anything he wants to do. In fact, if you look throughout history, most of the time he uses natural phenomena to bring around his miracle.
I mean, like parting the The Red Sea, right?
Parting the Red
For Moses?
Sea. Yeah. Lots of natural phenomena could have done that. The question is, how did it happen at just the right time, right?
I mean, I don't see how that could naturally happen, especially wide enough for all these chariots and everything to go through it.
There are many, actually, if you go online, there are many explanations of how this could naturally happen.
And then it would actually, I mean, you know, even on your theology, God is orchestrating it, right?
Yes.
So it wouldn't naturally happen. God is doing it.
Yeah, but he would use what we would call scientifically plausible things to do it, right?
Well,
he wouldn't have to violate the laws of physics to do anything. You might the thing we look at is why did it happen at that particular point, not how. For instance, God cannot do anything that is actually impossible. He can't make 1 + 1 equal to anything but 2, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in the same way, a lot of times he would say, well, okay, I have created the world with this physical phenomena. I'm going to maintain that physical phenomena, and I am going to work through it.
Okay, but don't you believe in Genesis? I mean, I'm just kind of perplexed as your answer is as a Christian. I mean, in Genesis it says he spoke things into being?
Yeah, but that's all part of the creation process, and that is a natural physical process.
Didn't it come from nothing, though?
Only the Big Bang came from nothing.
Okay, so if he can...
Everything else it says, bring out of his own kind, let the earth produce this, earth produce that, right?
Well, how did he bring it about? I mean, was it just by speaking it? I mean, you don't believe in evolution, so...
Well, I believe in intelligent design, so we would call it God-controlled. I don't believe in the evolution of man. I believe that God created multiple forms of life forms and things like that. Yeah.
But you don't believe animals.
But you also don't believe
that animals came from other animals. They didn't evolve from other animals.
I think some animals did. I think that's quite apparent.
But for example, cows did not come from a long line of, you know, something, you know, with fish, you know, for example. Fish did not come to cows.
Well, no, I don't believe cows came from fish, but I don't think that you believe that either, right?
Well, I do if you look at endpoints, but not directly, of course. But if you have endpoints, yes, I think the cows evolved from fish-like creatures, but...
Well, actually, right now we don't think that, because the tree of life concept is actually rapidly diminishing. Now the belief system, it's like a... Now the evolutionary tree of life has gone away. We don't find common ancestors. In fact, we find that it's probably more like a virus conversion, virus-transmitting genes from different hosts to different hosts.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. You're talking about horizontal gene transfer. That's
horizontal
one of the
gene transfer.
One of the
so the tree of life has been thrown... Not shouldn't be, say, thrown out. is rapidly losing favor, I should say. Mm-hmm. So I believe that God could have controlled that. I don't see anything problem with that. I think God controlled, I wouldn't call it God controlled evolution, but God controlled creation of new life forms.
But there is common descent, though. I mean, everything gave birth to some other thing, but you reject that. You believe that God made, for example, some kind of cow creature by itself, not from other animals which came from fish-like animals, right?
I'm not, you know, that's not, to me, once I believe that God exists, then evolution is a mechanistic issue, how he did it and why he did it. The only issue, of, as you've properly surmised, is I don't believe Adam and Eve were created through evolution. I think that was a specific creation.
Okay, so I kind of lost track. Did you want to ask me a question, or was I asking you a question?
I was asking you a question,
okay.
But it got into you asking me.
Okay.
Okay. But again, let me clarify this. So, because there's some confusion there, I said I think God mostly uses physical laws to bring about his thing, but he does make them happen, right? For instance, if Jesus wanted to convert water into wine, he would actually change the molecules as he needed using matter-energy conversion, right? It would not be that he would violate any physical laws unless he had to. I don't think he would need to violate any physical laws.
I don't understand how you can get from water to wine without
changing molecules.
Water is H2O, and wine is a very complex structure.
Right.
How could you rearrange H2O to get to wine?
No, matter-energy conversion. You could create matter from energy, right?
Oh, so the H2O would all convert to energy, and then
it would create back matter, yeah, right? So the real question we're asking is not that it's impossible, but it's improbable that he would have the access to that technology, right?
Well, the thing, too, is, you know, wine has so many emergent properties. Like, it depends on where it was grown, how it was stored, the grape, the season, and all that stuff.
And all could be designed into the converter. If I convert...
But it's all different. I mean, every wine crop is different. If you're going to make wine next year, you don't know what...
Did anybody say, oh, this wine came from this region and this region? No, they didn't. Right?
Yeah, but...
So you could put characteristics of the best wines the way you wanted to. If you were creating wine and you said, well, I know the characteristic of French wine is this, German wine is this, and I'm going to take the best of this and best of that, and I'm going to create a new kind of wine
that
people will like because it has all the best characteristics.
Because of the emergent properties, though, I don't think you can really come out the best, because it'd be kind of like saying, here's God made a beautiful woman, and she's the best... that you could come up with. Well, it's like, well, is it a redhead or a blonde? Some people think a redhead's better.
Okay.
And some people
well,
think
let's
a
put
blonde.
It this way. But God could make a beautiful woman. Now, it might not be your particular preference of beautiful women, you know, but you would still say, hey, she's beautiful, right? Because there are some characteristics of beauty that we all accept. That is symmetry, that is proportions, you know, these things that we say, hey, that's beautiful, right?
Yeah, but I think with just all these emergent properties come from real life things. For example, if I was born in a different country, I'd be a different person. I believe, because of the way I'm brought up.
Your environment has a lot to do with nurture and nature. Yes, I agree.
Either one of us could have been a Muslim if we were in a devout Muslim home, had an upbringing, and we could be, you know, defending Islam right now.
So why is that relevant, though? Because if we're basing our belief system on facts, if we're saying that, hey, we're going to – see, you're an atheist even though you were brought up in a Christian nation, right?
Yeah. I'm just – what I'm trying to illustrate, though, is the emergent principles on things. So like, you know, wine is because of a certain time and area and all that stuff. So I don't know how you can
say. And I would say it would be, if I were designing something, I can design something to be, you know, if I know that something is appealing, it doesn't have to be from, you know, as I said, nobody said, hey, this is great from the eastern part of Galilee. This is the perfect wine from there. It was he made it a wine and people enjoyed it. So I think that's sufficient. I don't know that the fine tuning of the wine is relevant, right? So
we're almost out of time, actually. So how about if we just summarize? We got 1 minute each, and then that's about our time's pretty much up.
Sounds good. Which I'm really enjoying this, by the way.
Okay.
So if you want to do it again, that'd be, you know, because I don't think we actually got to dig deep on certain things, and I'd love to dig deep on the actual creation event, why it has to be an intelligent agent, a free will agent, and I think those would be, because that's my argument right there, is that's probably the strongest part of the argument. It has to be a non-mechanistic first cause, which we never got time to go over.
Okay, so I'll just give a quick summary from my viewpoint, then you can give one from your viewpoint for about a minute. Let me look at my clock here. I think a worthless clock here, yeah. Okay, so... I'll just say basically, I think some of your arguments you came up with is about the creation of the universe, and I think a lot of that kind of comes down to the God of the gaps kind of thing. And personally, we didn't have a chance to talk this, but I do believe in the multiverse theory, and I would also note that there are Christians who also believe in multiverse theory. For example, there's this one scientist at Baylor University. It's a Christian, evangelical Christian university, and he's working in string theory and physics, and he believes in the multiverse, and he just thinks, hey, all these universes, that just gives more glory to God, you know? From the ancients, they thought we were just this little planet, and now we know there's more planets, there's more universes, there's billions of stars in our galaxy, there are billions of galaxies, there could be billions of universes. So it's not just for atheists only, basically, but it's still a conjecture. And then anyway, there's a whole lot. I accept evolution for the evidence of it, especially pseudogenes and DNA, and I'm too bad we didn't have a chance to talk about that. But that's just my brief summary, and you can give a brief summary now.
Okay. Well, as I said, we hadn't had a chance to cover what I think was the strongest point that I have, and perhaps in a later broadcast we can do it if you invite me back. But I did want to answer the multiverse. By the way, if you remember my introduction, I didn't say that the multiverse, I said the infiniverse. Because to be an atheist, you really have to believe in infinite universes. And the reason we have to believe in infinite universes, so I actually believe in multiverse. I have no problems with it. Just like the guy in Baylor, I think it's quite likely there are multiverses. But you have to believe in infinite universes. And the reason you have to believe in infinite universes is because you can't have a mechanistic first cause that does not create one thing, that only creates one thing that is not infinite years ago. So in other words, if there was a non-mechanistic first cause, he would have created a universe that was infinitely, a mechanistic first cause, he would have created a universe that was infinitely old. It couldn't have created a universe 13.7 billion years ago. There are only two options. One is there are infinite universes, or there's only one universe and it's infinitely old. And that explains the loop quantum cosmology, explains the bud universes, and all these other possible universes. So you have to have a non-mechanistic free will first cause to create one universe that's 13.7 billion years ago. And the infinite universes just are very unlikely, because that means there are millions and billions of copies of you and me out there having the same conversation, except you're the Christian and I'm the atheist.
All right. Thanks, Neil, for calling in, and I'll see if we – I don't know what my future schedule is yet. We might talk again. I appreciate the conversation. And just for those who are tuning in, I want to mention that if you're in the Portland, Oregon area, and let's say you want to meet other atheists or agnostics or even Christians or any kind of group, you can go to meetup.com and put in atheist and or Christian or whatever and put in your zip code, and it'll tell you the groups that are meeting. So for atheists, we have some groups like Humanist at Greater Portland. There's a Portland branch of CFI, Center for Inquiry. There's another group called Flying Spaghetti Monster Lands for a Pint, and there's one called Atheists, etc., etc. There's also some science and religion discussion groups. So go to meetup.com. It's a good place to search around for local groups. And that's it for our show today. Again, Neil, thanks for coming on.
Thank you.
All right. Bye.